Thanks everybody for joining us. Really excited by today's topic, and it comes with an even better host speaker. So many of you know Vindhya and were there at the previous talk that we did about social media addiction and everything, and a lot of people really enjoyed it. So really excited to have her back. And you all know Vindhya. You heard her exhaustive profile and accolades at the last event. So I'll just keep it a little bit short here. She's a performance coach and also a digital wellness coach. And as you know, she's has a really good message to share in terms of, creating healthy habits around our technology use in order to, improve our lives. So without further ado, I'd just like to invite Bindiya to, come here and really drop some knowledge bombs on us. So thanks for joining us,
Thanks,
Bindiya.
everyone, for having me back. It's really a pleasure.
Yeah, take it away. It's all yours. Floor is yours.
Okay, so of course, we're starting today by just having a little bit of a chat on what to do with our digital wellness. And it's become something which is really, really relevant, but I feel it's still extremely under-addressed as a topic because we all talk so much about our physical health, our mental, emotional health. But this is one of the topics which is, although so relevant to everybody, it just gets pushed to the side because perhaps we don't want to really look at it. It's so convenient to be flowing along in the digital bytes and bits that we don't want to take a step back and see what's happening with our habits. But I want to start by just talking a little about why digital wellness is so important to us today. So a lot of people keep asking me, like, what's this buzz about? Suddenly everyone's woken up and it's become a buzzword. Everyone's talking about a digital detox or digital wellness. But the reason it's so important to us today is because we spend most of our waking hours in one way or the other engaged with technology. It's become so all-encompassing. We work using technology. Our entertainment is through technology. We keep in touch with our friends, our family through technology. And we also perform a lot of our day-to-day chores actually using technology, be it shopping or making bookings or doing searches for something that we need. So technology is kind of percolated into every little empty crevice of our life.
This scene of us being zombies, it doesn't really, because it's so socially acceptable to be, on the beck and call of your phone and your notifications, you don't feel like a zombie, but from looking from the outside in, this is really truthful. So that's what I just
If you
want.
look at this image, for example, this is what you see everywhere you go. You go to a cafe, people are just looking down at their screens. You go to an airport, nobody's even looking around to see what's happening because we're all so engaged and drawn and hooked to our screens that we don't often even realize that there's a whole world existing outside of our screens. So, which is why this image, even though, like you said, it's graphic, but if you think of it, it's really true. This is how most of the world has become today.
Exactly. But what it does bring us to is, there has been a lot of call recently. I'm not sure if you guys have seen the documentary The Social Dilemma by Netflix, which is a great documentary to see about, the role that all this technology plays in our lives. But it seems that there's been like a big buzz around digital wellness, especially during the pandemic. And it's been one of those things that have happened just because of the pandemic. So why do you think that is? Why do you think there's been such a call to just digital wellness in general and more healthy habits regarding our technology?
Like I said, Rohan, I think it's because we can't ignore it anymore. It's just there so much in our face that either we see it, acknowledge it for what it is, and act on it now, or we're going to see really, really like a new kind of epidemic, which is a digital epidemic where the addiction has taken us to places where we're suffering socially, mentally, and physically. So it's about time that we started talking more about it. Perhaps the pandemic has been a catalyst because everyone's been spending so much time on technology, and you can see the visible impact of that on people. And I have to say, technology is a great thing. It's an enabler. It makes us do wonderful things, stay connected. And there's so many people, had it not been for technology, they would have been completely lost during the pandemic, be it like, you know, whether staying in touch with people or even being able to work from home. So it is a good thing, but the problem is, like I said, too much of a good thing is really bad for us. And this kind of dependence, where we can't seem to draw ourselves back from the screen and our life starts existing on that screen, that's the bad part. But it's come and gotten highlighted because of the pandemic, perhaps being the catalyst for this. And of course, anything that comes on Netflix becomes really mainstream now. So it's really good that The Doc has come out at such a time where people are also sitting at home. They don't have too much to do outside. So they actually get to consume more stuff on Netflix and watch stuff like this, which makes you, if nothing else, at least take a step back and reevaluate that what is my relationship with technology? And am I using it or am I getting used by it? So I think that's pretty much why so much mainstreaming is happening on this topic right now.
So I'm glad you mentioned, trying to take a step back. And when you do, when you try and take those steps back, usually it comes to either, doing a digital detox or trying to introduce some more sense of digital wellness in your life. So next thing that I wanted to kind of talk about is, the difference between the two. So digital detox and, what is the difference between digital detox and digital wellness in general?
Well, I'm glad you asked because people seem to use it interchangeably, but it's not actually interchangeable. So when we talk about digital wellness, we're talking about creating an ongoing state of balance between us and technology, essentially how we are consuming technology and how much time we're spending engaged with technology. Whereas when we talk about detox, we're talking about really pulling back and going into a period of abstinence, so to say, because we've already I mean, a detox will only happen when you've already gone overboard and you've already consumed too much and it's impacting you in some way, or you can see that happening in the near future. So a detox is really like that step back where you say, for some time, be it an hour every day, be it a day a week, be it a month, whatever it is, but I'm going to really pull back and cleanse myself, detoxify myself of the excessive engagement and exposure that I have with technology. So it's pretty much like how a physical detox works. If your body's in balance, if you're already in a state of wellness, you don't need to go for a detox. But when you have a lot of toxins in your body because you've overdone something, maybe you've been drinking too much or partying too hard or eating all the kind of like all the wrong food that you shouldn't be eating, then you say, okay, I think my system needs a detox. I'm going to take a step back and do that. So similarly, we're trying to do the same thing with a digital detox. As opposed to digital wellness is the broader term, but through, I mean, detox is one of the tools that we can use to achieve digital wellness. But you can also achieve digital wellness by implementing small steps in your daily life and not even doing a full detox in the extreme sense of the word.
Thank you for that. And I think we'll go on a little bit in more detail about what a digital detox entails a little bit later into in the presentation. But moving on then, another thing I wanted to talk about is how we kind of get to know that we actually have that real problem. How we know that we need to not only just do some digital wellness in our life, but also go full throttle digital detox. And I think that has to do more with digital addiction. So can you talk about that a little bit?
So when we talk about digital addiction, essentially what it is an impulse control disorder where we just cannot control our impulse to engage with the screen, be it on the phone or the laptop. Whatever it is that we're consuming is not the point, but the fact is that we're drawn constantly and unable to put a pause to that impulse. So that's what really comprises the definition of digital addiction. It's really when you get quite obsessive in your use of technology, be it your phone, your laptop, just gaming, any kind of other consumption that you're doing via a screen, because we have to understand that it's not the screen which is to blame, but it's what we consume on that screen and how that draws us in and makes us obsessive in our need to go back constantly, engage constantly. And that is what makes us addicted. The more we go, the more addicted we get. And that creates, a lot of problems, like a lot of adverse effects happen with that. But we can, of course, address that as we go along, that what are the adverse effects, not just smartphone companies work with attention engineers. They're the same people who work with, gambling, for instance, to see what are the behaviors and what are the triggers that they can plant in different sort of apps and softwares to get you hooked onto them.
So we've talked about digital addiction, and we wanted to kind of shine some light on the signs of digital addiction. So
yeah.
How do you know that you're starting to have a problem?
So the very first thing is that when we're addicted or when we have an unhealthy level of dependence, it starts interfering with our work and our personal life. How that plays out is that the very first thing that gets hit in terms of work is our productivity. So either we need to spend more time finishing the same amount of stuff, or we get lesser done, and we're constantly getting distracted in the middle by different things, like different windows which are not work related, by our phone, by communicating, sending messages back, and all of that. So at work, it plays out like that. But in our personal life, it also plays out in our interactions and the quality of our interactions. So are you in a social environment where you're sitting with someone, like much like these people, and you see the scene ever so often these days that two people are out or four, six people are out, but everyone's on their devices. If your social interaction looks anything like this, then I think you're obviously going towards the danger zone. Once in a way, checking a phone is fine, but if you're constantly looking at your screen and you're not actually spending time with the person in front of you because you're so interested in spending time with the person on the screen, and then you meet that person on the screen and you end up doing the same thing and you're still spending time with somebody else who's not present there, that is a problematic sign for you to note. Then if you have this urge to instantly respond to your phone, like any alert, any notification, you just want to grab it right then and there, you get really impatient, you want to see who it is, respond to them, or at least check out what the notification is, that's another really big sign to look out for. Then it's something many people are guilty of, even though they don't really own up to it. But are you taking your phone everywhere, including to the loo? Are you taking it to the dining table? Are you taking it to the loo? Do you need to have it next to you even when you're showering? Is it next to you at bedtime? That, again, big, big warning sign. Then one of the things you'll see happening more and more, and perhaps each of us may have noticed it at least once or several times, but depends the frequency of how much this happens to you, is that you start to panic when your battery is low, when your battery is dying, when there's no network, or God forbid that horrible thing happens to you where your phone is lost or where you've broken your phone. If this in any way creates panic, it's a sign of overdependence or addiction again.
So I know that you wanted to talk about social media depression, and how does that work with other people, and is that actually far, like, widespreading, or can people actually get over that depression of not having the social media?
You know, when you look at this image, it's a very telling image, Rohan, because this is how people seem to actually react and feel that they're going to collapse if they don't have access to their social media, like a part of their world is going to be destroyed. But social media depression is a very, very real thing. And the way it works is that we, even though we may consciously know this, but somehow when we go and very excessively engage with social media, most of the stuff that comes out there are very curated images of people's lives. They are their showreel moments, which have been polished and buffed and made to look really wonderful and then put out there. So how many times do you really find a person looking scraggly with zits on their face and having like puffy eyes, and there's like, oh, there's me on social media. But you'd find lots of pictures where everyone's looking really good. They're wearing their best clothes. And those are the pictures you'll find there. And on top of that, they've used filters. Everyone's looking fantastic. Or people are actually doing, you know, their online gloating, like something really good happened to me. Look at this car that I bought or this amazing group of friends that I have. So everyone is curating their experience to in some way make their life look better than it really is, even if it's one filter better than what it really is.
And I just wanted to expand a little bit more on what you were saying, and in terms of taking actual professional help and going on a digital retreat, what happens on a digital retreat exactly, and how can we figure out if it's something that we really need in our lives?
So like Joan, the way to figure out if you really need it is that if you find that you're spending, if you, like, you know, we ran through those list of things that I was asking everyone to keep a tab of to see if you're really in that level of addiction. If you are, the next step is to try the DIY process that we spoke about. But if you find that despite trying that, or that you're not managing to try it because you just keep falling off the wagon every time and you just can't do it by yourself, then it is time to take a step back and go for a proper structured retreat that will help you. Because like any addiction, sometimes you cannot kick an addiction on your own. Sometimes you need intervention. And that's all right. There's nothing wrong with it at all. Because at least you're aware of it. At least you're trying to do something to improve your own health. And if you are in that place, by all means, go. And what happens at a digital detox retreat is the very first thing that happens is, like with any substance, let's say you even have an alcohol addiction and you go to an AA center, the first thing you have to do is that the substance is taken away from you. But here, we understand that people, it's not realistic for anyone to live without technology in this day and age. So what we do is that we start off in a digital detox retreat by completely taking the technology away to see how you respond. How anxious are you? How panicked do you get? What is the physical state that you get into? Because I often see clients who come for digital detox reacting exactly the same way as any other addict. They get restless, they're angry, they say mean things. They have high anxiety, moods are just going all over the place. They don't know what to do with themselves. So it's exactly the same symptoms that a lot of substance addictions cause. So for that period of time, the devices will be taken away from you fully. And then there will be several processes of evaluating what is the nature of your addiction. Is it more than just the fact that you formed a physical habit, or are there underlying issues? Like we discussed, so many issues and so many ways in which addiction plays out. It has to do with loneliness, with self-esteem, with our social environment, with just the state of our life as we may perceive it. So once we've evaluated that, because we want lasting impact, we don't just want that, okay, devices are taken away, devices are given, go back to your pattern. We want to be able to see that what are the psychological factors that may be impacting this kind of addiction. And once we evaluate those, then we move to the point where we say, okay, let's address these and then slowly reintroduce the devices back into your life, but start putting boundaries and help you find sustainable ways to maintain those boundaries thereafter. So once you are at that point where you're like, okay, I'm comfortable now, this is the level of engagement, that is when you're ready to then check out from your program, go back, and then stay on maintenance, just to make sure with whoever your therapist is, with whom you've done the program, to make sure that you've not got derailed. And in case you have, also, then how do we get you back on the wagon? And that's the only, like, you know, premise on which this works. So it's all right, like any addiction, it's all right to keep falling off the wagon as long as you keep wanting to get back and do something to get back. And as long as the intervals between those falls keep increasing. That's all we have to keep in mind. So it is something which is doable for everybody, like any addiction. It's something you can kick, but because this is such a socially acceptable addiction and it's kind of just there and so insidious in so many ways, we don't notice it. So I hope, if nothing else, that at least from at the end of the session, that everyone will take a step back to at least reflect for a moment or two and just analyze what your patterns and what your relationship with technology really is, and if it's healthy or if it's unhealthy. And if it's unhealthy, then I really, really encourage everyone to do something about it.
Yeah, so thank you, Bindiya, so much for another great session. And you've suddenly given me a lot to think about. I think you've given all of us a lot to think about as well. And thank you for also sharing your expertise with us.
I'm so glad I could do this with all of you. Thank you so, so much for having me.